Welcome to the second hour of Balance of Power. I'm Joe Matthew in for David Westin today, and we start with the big story of the day. The jobs report, with the headline on the terminal, U.S. hiring slows sharply amid Delta complicating Fed taper. And joining us now, David Bahnsen, Chief Investment Officer at the Bahnsen Group. David, welcome. We're all asking the same questions today. We know that COVID is getting a lot of blame for this lower than expected number, much lower than expected in some cases. People are wondering, though, if this is temporary or if we are actually in the process of redefining the job market, if some of these losses are in fact permanent.
Well, we certainly want to hope that they're not. Oftentimes, when people are out of the labor force for this long, it does become structural. And it's the big risk, I think, that policymakers took with this approach in the pandemic and the extension of that federal supplemental benefit. But I do believe that there are signs of life in there. There are definitely in those states that did opt out of the federal supplement. There were signs that people began going back. Leisure and hospitality did not go backwards in this report, despite that ongoing supplement and despite the Delta ramifications. And so we really have to see in Q4, once the September moment has come and gone, what the kind of structural hangover ends up looking like.
I know you, like many, are concerned about a labor participation rate that didn't budge, and this was supposed to be the beginnings of the coming back. How much of a problem is that if people are giving up looking for work?
Well, it's a big problem, but much less so economic and more so cultural. I think that the existential reality we've seen ever since the labor participation force began a sort of secular decline, and this is far before COVID. This has been going on for a long period of time. I think it's bad for our society, bad for human dignity when people give up on the idea of being engaged in the workforce. But if we're only limiting ourselves to the economic ramification, it's still quite negative. There is a tremendous advantage to having people both at the very beginning of a career and in later stages of life of being engaged in the workforce. And unfortunately, both of those bookends, we're seeing declines in labor participation force. And as I said, I think that has both an existential and cultural ramification, but economically, it takes away from productivity.
David, we know leisure and hospitality took a hit here, and that's not surprising if we're talking about a COVID story. But I wonder if there were any beams of light in this report for you. Were there areas that saw growth?
Well, no, there weren't any that saw growth month over month that stand out. The number was so far below the headline expectation. And so I think the silver linings are more in things like wage growth, which ironically, a lot of people this morning have spent the morning bemoaning, concerned
right.
that there's inflationary stickiness in the wage growth. But I don't think so. I think that what you see is wage growth coming because of competitive drivers and market forces that will normalize. But it does fall in that category, Joe, the Q4. What is going to be the case when that September moment comes and goes? Ideally, the things I'd like to see for bright spots, our leisure and hospitality get back within 90% of pre-pandemic levels. It's made great progress, but it still has room to go, and it's really the only sector that's still significantly lagging. So we want to see leisure hospitality get all the way back, and then, of course, contained wage growth and improved labor participation force.
Well, in a country that's worried about inflation right now, I heard Rick Rieder from BlackRock this morning on Bloomberg talk about the incredible jump in hospitality and leisure wages, the six-month annualized increase, something like 23%. Is that sustainable for employers?
Definitely not, and it won't be sustained. And so that's why employers don't have to worry, because that percentage growth is not going to happen.
It
reflects very, very idiosyncratic events. There is a base effect in there. There is the shortages that we dealt with throughout the summer, the pent-up demand. So I think we're analyzing data for normalization in abnormal times. But to the extent that type of number can raise some eyebrows, I certainly understand. And I thought readers' comments this morning were very helpful. Mm. But the fact of the matter is that it is not going to be normative. The question is 5% going to be normative? Even that would be too high from a profit margin standpoint.
So take us to the Fed, David Bahnsen. Did this report just buy policymakers a couple of months of relief?
Well, I will tell you, the Fed did not need a couple months of relief because they were not going to taper in September anyways. And anyone who listened to Jackson Hole's speech knew that, and all of the telegraphing and not to mention market expectations. The Fed is not going to shock the market. And the Fed has done a masterful PR job at telling everybody who's listening exactly what they're going to do, which is get more serious about talking about it in December and either actually start to taper the bond purchases very late this year or very early next year. So this report does help give them a bit more cover, but it doesn't give them cover to a new direction. It gives them cover to what they were going to be doing anyways.
So this doesn't change anything?
No, I don't think it does. I think it plays into some of the conversation points, but yeah. It looks to me as if the voting members of FOMC and certainly Chairman Powell himself have already determined that they're giving the market 4 to 6 months notice, and the market is taking it in stride.
David Bahnsen, Chief Investment Officer at the Bahnsen Group, we thank you for the insights on this Jobs Day.